Hi everyone, welcome to the RX 7900 XTX buying guide. As usual, we will compare which models have better coolers, VRMs, and power limits. The cooler design is especially important on these cards, where the better cards will run cooler and quieter, but also because the VRMs and power limits doesn't matter quite as much on the 7900 XTX. As usual, any RX 7900 XTX will perform similarly at default. It's only when you overclock that the more capable cards will see performance differences. But even if you don't plan to overclock, there is no downside to picking a better card as long as you don't pay significantly more. On the RX 7900 XTX, basically all the cards use the same VRM, with a few exceptions. That means that all the cards are just as capable in terms of VRMs. The reference specification by AMD seems to be a 17-phase by 70-amp VRM, totaling 1190 amps for the core, and a 3-phase by 70-amp VRM totaling 210 amps for the memory. You might notice that this is an incredibly powerful VRM compared to the Nvidia cards. And you would be right. This VRM is used on the majority of the different cards, and it is more than enough to power the Navi 31 GPU on the RX 7900 XTX, even with an unlocked power limit. Only the ASRock cards use an 18-phase VRM for the GPU core, and also ASRock, ASUS, and PowerColor opting to go with a 4-phase VRM for the memory. This small advantage is pretty negligible since the reference specification is already extremely overkill. So I wouldn't stress about the VRM differences on these cards, as all of them are basically just as capable. Now for the power limits on these AMD cards, there are some differences to how Nvidia cards handle power limits that we need to discuss. On Nvidia cards, the power limit is a hard cap for the power consumption of the whole card that is measured off the chip using a separate shunt resistor and a power monitoring chip to measure the power consumption coming into the card itself. On AMD cards, the power limiter is defined by a package power tracking limit that has both a short and long duration limit, similar to how AMD handles power limits on their CPUs. The power consumption is then measured by the VRM controller itself. The result is that the VRM power losses, the fans, and the RGB LEDs on the cards are not monitored and controlled by this power limit, unlike on the Nvidia cards. This is why the PPT of the AMD cards are lower than their real-world power consumption. The maximum allowable increase in power limit from the default setting is also a flat 15% for all the cards, hence why I only list the default power limiters in the short and long term PPT, since you can deduce the max power limits by just adding 15% on top of both of those limits. What overclockers won't like from this method of power limiting is that it's not easily bypassed like on Nvidia cards, where you can just do a shunt mod to fool the card that it's using less power than it is. On AMD cards, you need to be able to access the I2C interface of the voltage controller and change its power monitoring scaler to report lower power to the GPU. Previously, you can use the More Power tool by Iger's Lab on the RX 6000 series to do this, while on the new RX 7000 series cards, AMD has cut off access to this interface via software. So the only method is to solder an Elmore EVC interface to the voltage controller directly, not exactly a method that most people would do for a daily driver system. This means that a high power limit is important for AMD cards since it's difficult to modify the power limit yourself. But even then, the power limiters on these higher-end cards are still not quite enough. Since an overclocked RX 7900 XTX with a fully bypassed power limiter using the Elmore EVC can see upwards of 700 watts of reported power when running at near 3.4 GHz. So actually, the ASRock Aqua with its extreme VBIOS update that allows a default of 480 watt PPT is perfect. It is possible to flash this ASRock Aqua VBIOS into the other cards, but only through flashing the original ASRock Aqua VBIOS onto the card you have using an SPI programmer and then running the ASRock Aqua VBIOS updater. Which means, again, this isn't the easiest way to BIOS mod and get more power to your RX 7900 XTX. But this may be a good option for the enthusiasts that want to daily drive an overclock RX 7900 XTX. Now for the cooling performance of the different cards, you can't directly compare temperatures from different reviews since their test conditions are different. So I gather the performance results measured by TechPowerUp, since they always reviewed the most different models, and then other reviewers to then combine the results by correcting the temperatures to TechPowerUp's results. By calculating the average delta temperature and noise measured by the same cards that TechPowerUp tested and applying a correction to any card that isn't tested by TechPowerUp, which lets me combine the results from different reviews to a single graph with reasonable accuracy that it's good enough for comparisons. Here we can see the temperatures are never really an issue with any of the RX 7900 XTX, which isn't surprising considering that all the cards have massive coolers. All the cards have coolers that are capable to keep GPU temperatures under 60 degrees, and hotspot temps never really get above around 80 degrees when it's working properly. Unfortunately, the AMD reference card did have some issue with its vapor chamber during the early production runs that some of you may have one that's affected by it. If so, you would see hotspot temps over 100 degrees and you should definitely return it to AMD because they are doing a recall for it. Unfortunately, there aren't also any memory temperature sensors on the RX 7900 XTX. But since it uses the cooler GDDR6 memory instead of GDDR6X on Nvidia cards, it shouldn't really be an issue in the first place, so I wouldn't worry about memory temps too much as all the cards seem to also cool their memory in the proper way. On the RX 7900 XTX, it is interesting to note that the quiet modes of the cards all have lower power limits than the performance modes, which manifests in either higher noise levels from increased fan speeds on the performance mode, like the XFX Merc, ASRock Taichi, and ASUS TUF, or higher temperatures in the performance mode since they keep the fan speeds low, like on the Sapphire Nitro. If you consider all the factors, the ASRock Taichi is definitely the best cooled card, since this card has the highest power limit while still staying as quiet as the Sapphire Nitro and ASUS TUF, and beating them in both the temperatures as well. The power color Hellhound also performed pretty well, looking like being in the middle of the pack in terms of cooling performance. This makes sense since it's also quite a huge card. The XFX Merc, on the other hand, seems to just not have that great of a cooler despite the huge size. It's either much noisier to run cooler or almost as noisy as the reference card while having temperatures that get bested by the ASRock Taichi, so I don't think the XFX card has the best designed cooler. For the other cards that don't have any reviews yet, here's a tier list that I came up with. As per usual, this isn't 100% accurate as it's all my estimation from seeing the cards that were reviewed and comparing them to how the coolers from these other non-reviewed cards are built, considering their size and their material as well as their design and the fans that they have. This should still be accurate enough that the cards in the same tier will perform pretty similarly in terms of cooling performance. There's no particular order inside the tiers themselves aside from the alphabetical order. So here we can see that basically all the cards are great for the RX 7900 XTX. Honestly, I wouldn't have any issues with buying either of them, at least excluding the early AMD reference card that had issues with the vapor chamber causing insanely high hotspot temps. I don't know how the partners did this well on the RX 7900 XTX, but it does seem like the general build quality and cooler design is much higher than partner cards using Nvidia GPUs. If I had to guess, this might be due to AMD pricing their GPUs cheaper and therefore letting the partners get a bigger cut of the sale price of the GPUs, allowing them to design better quality cards and still make a profit, while on the Nvidia camp, all the partners have to skimp and cut corners everywhere to even make a profit on a sale. Which shows in the cheaper models like, for example, the MSI Ventus or the cheaper Zotac Trinity cards and such like that, which clearly cuts corners. While on AMD's side, there isn't really any cards to that level. Which I guess coincides with the reason that EVGA backed out of making Nvidia GPUs. Lastly, here is the overall tier list of all the cards. This is not in any particular order within the tiers except for alphabetical order, as the cards are pretty closely matched in this generation. If any manufacturer disagrees with this tier list, please contact me and convince me why your card should be higher by sending me a review sample or explaining to me why so that I can see for myself. Otherwise, I am very confident in the tiers that I place the cards at, and the point of this tier list is to help buyers buy a higher tier card whenever possible in their budget, so that you're paying always for the best card possible. Buying a higher tier card if it's the same price as a lower tier card that you are looking at. In the end, since the cards are overall very high quality and well built, I would say that the tier list is really only by the power limits that they set in the VBIOS, which would obviously put the ASRock Aqua with its extreme VBIOS on top. Then this is followed by the rest of the cards in the order of their power limiters. I really don't see any reason to knock any of the cards down for the cooling performance or VRMs, since they are all very overbuilt. Even the XFX Merc, which I said didn't have that great of a cooler, it still performs way better than the reference card, so I really don't think that is an issue either. A very different landscape than comparing different partner cards for Nvidia GPUs, where I usually have to really consider which cards does cut corners and make them really unrecommendable. While on the AMD cards here, you can see basically all the cards are meeting and exceeding my expectations on a high-end graphics card like the RX 7900 XTX. With a very good VRM on all the cards, large coolers that can keep up with the GPU, and also power limiters that, albeit still not enough just because the GPUs are really high power consumption, are all pretty generous in general compared to Nvidia GPUs. That is all for this buying guide. I hope that this video helped you a little bit in picking out an RX 7900 XTX, although it does really seem like you can't go wrong with either of them. But, well, if you do find something wrong with any of the cards, leave a comment down below if you own them, and also leave a like if I made you feel better about your RX 7900 XTX purchase. And as always, subscribe if you don't want to miss more buying guides like this. Thanks for watching.